Okay, good afternoon, or good morning for some people that are on the other coast, or good night for people from other parts of the world. We'll do a field trip through the mineral collection of the New York State Museum. My name is Marian Lupulescu. I am museum scientist and curator of geology at the New York State Museum. Now, as you can see here, we have a lot of cabinets and a lot of shelves that contains minerals and rocks also. On the right side cabinet is the New York collection, minerals of New York. On the left side are the other cabinets that are a little bit bluish gray. There are minerals that are from other part of the world. We said world collection. Even the minerals are from New Jersey or from Massachusetts. But being outside of New York, we call them old collection. Now a little bit about the mineralogy in New York State. Small history. The first information we have about mineral collecting and something written about minerals in New York is from Dr. Samuel Mitchell in 1798-1799. He was a doctor in medicine, and he wrote a medical repository, and there are some pages about a sketch of the natural mineralogical history of New York. After this, in 1799, appears the first Mineralogical Society of America here in New York City. In 1810 to 1814, it was the apparition by Archibald Bruce of the journal that is called American Mineralogist, but not the same as American Mineralogist as it is today. In 1816 was another treatise on the mineralogy and geology of New York by Cleveland, and in 1818 was another work on the mineralogy of New York. Of course, that were very empirical works, but they were the first that appeared. The most important work on the mineralogy of New York is from Louis Caleb Beck. It was 1837 when Governor William Marcy hired a few geologists to do a survey of the New York State resources. And one of them was Utica born, but working at Rutgers University in New Jersey. And it was Louis Caleb Beck that practically did the first mineralogical survey of New York. And in 1842, he published a big, around 400 pages, book about mineralogy of New York. The collection he amassed at that time is the core of the collection we have today. After this, there were other people. Some of them were with mineralogy or geology affiliation. Mostly are only mineral collectors. They have different other jobs, a different other purpose, but they like minerals and they collect it. Now, how can you think that the collection is built? First, by a normal or collection of this side, by donations, they are most important. After this, purchase. After this, exchange. And field collecting. But field collecting, it's very difficult for one person to do a lot of work outside because everybody has a job. And even if it is a mineralogist, he can spend 24 hours from 24, 7 days a week to collect minerals. Donations are most important because people that love New York State Museum, that when they feel that their life is toward the end, they started to donate their lifelong collecting minerals to the New York State Museum. And we preserve their name and the date when they did it on the labels we have at the minerals. Now, how big is the collection? Because I said a little bit about We have around 50,000 records for the minerals. A record doesn't mean the number of specimens, means only the entry in the catalog. Because, for example, for the Herkimer diamonds, we have a record, but we have sometimes 100 mineral specimens that are under that record. That is the problem. We have also a meteorite collection with 38 specimens. We have a gem collection with 2,000 specimens. We have an economic geology collection with around 1,000 specimens. Another one is the rock collection, that rocks that are from different parts and different geological units of New York State, around 2,000 specimens. And also we have a teaching collection that is used for different studies for kids, with around 500 specimens that cover from sedimentary igneous to minerals. Now, how do we record all the specimens we have? We have an online database. First, it is in a soft that is Access, which is a working database. And after we complete all the information we have of the minerals in the Access database, we'll transfer them to MIMSI database, which is the biggest database of the museum that contains all the collections here in the museum. How the minerals are organized here, you see there are rows and rows of cabinets full of minerals. And we start from cabinet number one, then go around and around and around. What is the reason to do this? Here are the native elements, that the simple composition. Then going and going and going for more and more complex composition and more complex structures. Like you see in this first cabinet, it's graphite. You know, graphite is carbon only. That is the composition. It is not very nice. Some people said it's not very nice, but if you look at these ones, sometimes they can show very nice specimens. Mostly specimens we have here, it is from Ticonderoga. Probably people that are a little bit older, they know about Ticonderoga pencils. That was the pencil ore from this graphite deposit. Until the graphite from Sri Lanka became more and more cheap and practically make the Ticonderoga too close. But Ticonderoga can be used for mineral collecting, but asking permission from the owners of the property. They are very nice people, and if you want to collect some minerals, you can go there and collect minerals. Going a little bit further, we'll stop at from graphite, we'll stop to sulfides. And one of the most interesting sulfides here in New York is the sphalerite, which is a zinc sulfide. And you can see there, here, you have some of them in very dark colors, some of them a little brownish, some of them are yellow, and you will see another part, which is they are colorless. This is because of their composition. Some of them are iron-rich, some of them are no iron-rich, and for this we have different composition of them. And look at this specimen, it's a very interesting association, is the sphalerite with halite. It is from a deposit, one of the most well-known deposits, not only in New York, but on the world, is the Balmat Edward deposit. These are two new specimens that appeared last year from the mine, when they reopened the mine. Of course, it was very difficult to find something new at this moment after they reopened the mine, but we were able to find them. And, of course, to purchase other stuff. See, some of them are gem-like specimens, like these ones here. Or this one that is, see, in quartz, very nice yellow transparent, flawless in quartz with some hematite around here. Some of them, like this one that you see, the colorless ones, are strongly fluorescent in UV light. Even short or long wave light, they are strongly fluorescent. Unfortunately, we can do this here, but we have it down at the first floor in the collection, Minerals of New York. We have these minerals under UV light. Going a little bit further, some people will say, why do you want to show us pyrite? Pyrite is so common for everybody. Look what I want to show you, pyrite. Look at them. They were from a pit at Interstate 81 in Nedrow in New York. Normally at this moment the collection, we have most of the minerals that were collected from that part. And now it's not possible because the pit is closed, which is normal by people that do it. And the minerals, the specimens, are a little bit bathed in hydrochloric acid to get rid of the carbonates, and it remains only the shells that contain these beautiful crystals. And going a little bit up here, let's see this stuff. It's a pyrite, yeah, isn't it? But you know what it is? The former, you know, the, let's say, proto-lead is more than 400 million years old because it was feces from Devonian fish. That organic matter was transformed and replaced by pyrite. Looking at this, or looking at this one, you can see how big the Devonian fish were at that moment. What we have today, it's only what remains. And to see more interesting, see this. That is the, practically the shell. And what is this pyrite here is the organic matter that went out from the shell and was replaced by pyrite. And this happened in the water that lack oxygen. And after this, it was practically compacted and covered by other sediments.
We have someone that said that it has a weird shape.
Yes, it has. It's nice. Okay. Other type. And probably you've seen some of them are in jars. That is because pyrite has a disease sometimes. That means that in contact with air, it started to decay. And to preserve the specimens, we put in mineral oil. That is a way to preserve the mineral that with air, they started to break. No. Okay. Well, yes. We're going to a more complex. It was here iron sulfur 2. Now again iron 3, iron 2, oxygen 4. Then what we have here are these very nice specimens. Probably you know about the iron oxide, magnetite, hematite. And magnetite here, it is very special. If you look at the shape they have, they are almost cubes. Cubes of magnetite are completely unusual. But there are some deposits in the world that have cubic magnetite, but not of this size. This is the deposit, it's the Balmat, at number 4 mine in Balmat, that has the biggest cubes of magnetite at this moment. We don't know more if they will find other in other parts, but at this moment we have this. And they have a lot of here or here. We have other. Some of them are, see, the same as this on the sphalerite. They are with halite. And you see also the sphalerite, the colorless sphalerite we've seen in the other stuff. here there are collection of small crystals that were detached from the specimen. And if you look at the labels, they have practically the same labels. They comes from the same collection, which is one of our biggest donors. Former professor of Syracuse University had donated each year he donates us around 100 boxes of minerals.
We have a lot of people who think they're very pretty.
Oh yes, they are. Okay, let's go a little bit further. Wow, look what is here. This is a calcium fluoride. It's called fluorite. And there are some Paleozoic formations in central western New York that contains some pockets with calcite, dolomite, with sphalerite, with some celestine, with gypsum and fluorite. And we have a big collection of fluorite from all kind of location from central and western New York. Some of them, look at this one, they are big, really. Some of them are, look, they have a phantom inside with another color. Some of them are colorless. Mostly are blue, or they are a little bit, you know, purplish.
And I have a question if all of them have purple in them.
Why? Because it's possible that to be some center of colors in these minerals, and sometimes is the purple is very strong, it is probably of the radiation that could be. Of course, not strongly radioactive minerals, but in the environment they form. And we have also other type of fluoride. See, there are layers of fluoride. Some of them are big, like that ones. That appear. These ones are from a locality in St. Lawrence County called Macomb. Fluorite, Macomb is a town there, but we call Macomb locality. There is information where the pit was, and there are some people that want to reopen the pit to try to mine again the fluorite, but we don't know what happened because of the timing and very difficult to work there. Okay, then here, let's go a little bit further and to look for one of the, in my opinion, this is the most interesting group of minerals that I love. A lot of people said, why? Because they are dark, they are ugly minerals. No, they are not. Look. Let's see, are these ugly? Not at all, isn't it? Not even that one is ugly. Or look at this one here, or this one, or this one here. No, they are not ugly. Or this one here. They are colored, not only dark mineral, not only black in color, they are also colored. And here we can talk a little bit about the chemical diversity in mineral species. And we can look at this one. This mineral is tremolite, isn't it? Okay. This one, the green one here, is also tremolite, yes? This one is tremolite. But they have different colors. What is? This is the normal color of the tremolite. If some chromium in small amounts enter into the composition, the color is changed to this green. If the manganese enter into the tremolite, it changes in purple or pink. And purple or pink depends on the manganese state of oxidation, 2 or 3. That the color is different being a function of the minerals, of the mineral components. We have a lot of stuff here with minerals. Some of them, look at this one, it's a beautiful tremolite crystal. Some of them are big like this one. We have from this kind of tremolite, it's a little bit darker because it contains iron in the composition. We have big like 30, practically a foot long and half a foot in diameter amphiboles from that location.
We have a couple of questions. Are all of these from New York?
Yes. Everything I showed till now is from New York.
And the next question is, do you have any diamonds?
Yes, we have, but not from New York. There are no diamonds in New York. And a little bit later, I'll tell you the story about why there are no diamonds in New York. Yes, we'll talk about this soon. Okay, let's go a little bit further. And we'll go to the mica. Everybody loves mica. And look here. What do you think it is? This is a piece of mica, yeah, with this hieroglyphs on it that are practically iron and titanium oxide that were included in the cleavage of mica, of the muscovite. This is a muscovite. Careful, because it's the same is here. Look how nice abstract painting the Mother Nature did for us. Yeah. That is from a pegmatite is in Bachelorville, Saratoga County. It's a small, they are small, around 10 small pits there, but the minerals that were excavating from there are extremely big. See, we have another stuff here, which is phlogopite. Look at these very nice crystals. Or like this one, look how beautiful it is. It's a magnesium mica, this one. And this is also a phlogopite, which is also very interesting. And the color is not common for this kind of mica, for phlogopite. And a lot of people did all kind of analytical work to see why this color is. Didn't get any result. But if you cleave it and go, it's colorless. That probably it is something done by interaction between the light and the molecules from the specimen that give this. It's like, you know, probably many people know about Raman spectra. Well, for this, the sea water is blue, even it is not blue real, but it's interaction between the light and the water molecules.
We had a question about what are some of the uses of mica.
The mica in the old times are used as insulators and also for the windows instead of glass in the windows. And when, I don't know if everybody knows, because there are a lot of paintings, it was powdered and put in the paint, and it was painting the walls off because it was sparkly and it was nice and so on. I don't think somebody now uses this kind of stuff. But it is very interesting. Okay. We have a lot of stuff here, but I don't think you want to spend the whole day listening to me. You want more to see what we have. And we'll go to the first part. The first part are good for ceramics from the beginning. But there are also some first parts that look very nice, like these ones, and we call them amazonite. It's not a mineral. Amazonite is a varietal species, and it is only one locality in New York where the amazonite was practically mined, not really mined, but we can call mined, in 1915. That is because they needed hard rocks to build the Kensico Dam in White Plains, and they started to look for the hard rocks around there, and in the quarry they found a vein with amazonite, and most of the amazonite was taken by the miners, sold to the mineral collectors, and in this way it came to our collection.
We have a question about minerals in general. Can you only find them in caves, or can they be out on the ground?
The minerals, you can find them even in, depends. Now, if it is an igneous mineral, it is underground. It is a metamorphic mineral. It is also under, if it is a sedimentary one, you can find at the surface. And sometimes even the igneous or metamorphic minerals or hydrothermal minerals, hydrothermal means for from hot waters with chemically active ingredients, because you can find in on the surface because of the erosion. They are formed, let's say, 500 million years ago, but erosion till now make them accessible to the people. Most of the specimen I showed you till today was from the mines, but not only from the mines. And I'll show you others that are not from the mines. But these from the mines were very nice because they had time to crystallize because the temperature and the pressure was for many, many years the same, and the mineral were able to develop their potential to grow in this way. Now, again, also an answer to the last question, the lapis lazuli. The mineral is lazurite, but it is with some diopside, it is with zipyrite, and it forms what the gem people say lazurite. Look at this beautiful piece that is from the same, all these minerals from the Balmat Edwards mining district in North Country, in St. Lawrence County. A lot of minerals came from there, and we have and we still have contact with the people from there that collect minerals and ask us if we don't need them. Sometimes we say yes, sometimes we say yes, but later. But at the end they practically came to our collection. And look at this one, this is not polished, it's not beautiful color that can be very well polished and transformed into a cabochon or other kind of stuff. Okay, we'll go to the basic minerals now. I mean quartz. Okay, look how many diamonds we have here. See? Huge diamonds. Of course, they are Herkimer diamonds. It's the quartz, not real diamonds, but we'll go to the diamonds soon. Then, see, this is a record, has this number. But see how many crystals we have? That the number of specimens is more than I told you at the beginning. If we look for each record, how many minerals they are in it. And not only, but look at these. For these are called diamonds. Look how flawless they are, how short the long axis is, how nice the crystal is formed. Grow up in the cavity in limestone, dolostone. Sometimes it's associated with anthraxolite, which is a solidified oil. Sometimes with calcite. Very nice stuff. Okay, but not only, because look at these ones. There's show different stages of crystallization. You know, it's a kind of skeleton-like crystal that grew from the solution. It has different phases. They have different crystals that grew. They're very nice, and look at this one. Beautiful. Isn't it? Probably people is not so impressed with this Herkimer diamond because they've seen many times the Herkimer diamonds, but they are still very nice for everybody. Okay, let's go a little bit further. No. We went here, yes? Ah, we'll go to this sulfate. Look at this barium sulfate, it's barite. It is all you have here, probably we have the whole lot, 99% of the specimens from that location. It was a small cavity in the rock, one of our mineral collectors had a kid that went into that cavity. Unfortunately, he didn't do any picture to see how it looks like inside. Took everything and gave it to us. Unfortunately, it's very difficult to know exactly what was the position of these specimens in the cavity there. But they are very nice, very beautiful crystals. Also, San Lawrence County. San Lawrence County and Orange County down in southern New York gave out the most minerals. See? Other shapes. Look at this one, also from the same. For this, I said 99% of that small cavity is here, if you look, with very complex shapes, very complex aggregates, with the pure barite. Some of them, see, that have this bluish color. Probably they have some strontium in the composition. Very nice. Okay, now see that are not so nice. I can say ugly because they are minerals. The minerals are not ugly at all. And we had some of them, see, this, they were in the exhibition down there until we replaced them with other specimens that came later. Okay, let's go from this one to the sister. And the sister is Celestine. Look. Or here. Much better. It is from a locality called the Chitnango Falls. It's a park, Chitnango Falls, but this is not from the park. It's a road cut there. And at that moment, a lot of mineral collector went and started to collect and collect and collect. Now it's prohibited. Not because you can't collect, but it's dangerous. Being a like, you know, a very sharp road cut there, the people, you know what, they can be hurt and so on for this. You can stay there and look at them and so on. You find some specimens down there, but you are not allowed to climb and do because you can break your neck easy. In the old times, they did. No accident happened. Or you don't know.
Do you have barite from hydrothermal deposits?
We do.
You do?
Yeah. I can't show some. Yes. Immediately. Let's finish with this one and we'll go. Sure. Okay. Look here. I don't want to get around. Oh. My microphone. I lost. It's okay now? Okay. See? I can't go without showing the calcite. There are a lot of calcite, and these are not all of them. I only to show you some. Look at this calcite that is covered by pyrite. Other are with some hematite. They are a little bit. Other are yellowish. Others have some sprays of hematite and pyrite on them, or sometimes marcasite. But we have, not here, because they are very heavy, we have in our store facility at Rotterdam, we have around 200 crystals of calcite, pink calcite. One of them is more than 500 pounds. That enough was to bring it at the third floor here. It will be too heavy. It was from a cave. It was known as a Stirlingbush cave. Now it's on a Fort Drum property that is very difficult to get access there. Look. Manganese, again, that gave this pinkish color. That same very nice spray of pyrite on it from St. Joe lead mine. From St. Joe lead mine means Balmat. It was the old name of the mining company. A lot of stuff. Some of them are completely, see, beautiful, flawless and colorless crystals, only with manganese pink tint. Some of them has a very nice fluorescence, some of them no. Okay, let's go a little bit further. We still have time to explore the whole collection. Okay, I'll stop here. You know why? Because here is the official gem of New York. It's the garnet. And what you see here, see, this is only a fragment of the garnet from Barton Hill mines. Barton Hill is probably the locality in the world with the biggest garnets. The garnets are all the time surrounded by this black stuff, which is amphibole, a pergasite by name, this amphibole. And it was used for, because didn't have any very nice crystals or gem-like crystals, but you know, it's a gem, official gem of New York. It was used for abrasives, for sandpaper. And now it can be visited easy, of course, as a fee. And you can collect how much garnet you want from there for $1 per pound. Then not a problem. This, at this moment. But not all the minerals in New York are so ugly. Look, here it's also part of this Barton Hill mines. It's only a small fragment of a whole garnet. And we have also from, oops, got it. A lot of, we have also nicer garnets from a pegmatite in Westchester County, from a Bedford pegmatite. It is also an iron-rich garnet, which is called almandine. Unfortunately, that pegmatites are very nice, and the age is also very interesting, because it's the end of Icadian orogeny in New York. Then we were able to date, not the garnets, but the rock, you know, if the garnets are. There are two big localities there in Bedford. One, it is on private property, and one is on the land, state land property, but both are flooded. Not too much to see and take from there. Hey, we can't go further without looking at this beautiful blue mineral that is serendibite. Serendibite, it is a boron silicate, very nice. There are not more than, I think, 6 or 7 localities in the world that contain these minerals. And we have here a lot of from that locality, which is in southern Adirondack. Some of them were described in papers that analyze these minerals. You can see the shape of the crystal here in the calcite, and they are associated with phlogopite, and phlogopite, you've seen that magnesium mica, and other boron minerals that can be seen by naked eye, unfortunately. Okay, let's go to tourmaline. Wow, you know how people in the old times called tourmaline? It was somebody that wrote about tourmaline saying that this is because of the composition, saying it looks like a medieval recipe written by a doctor because it has a lot of elements in the composition. Other people called it a trash bin. Because if you look at the formula, it's a very long formula, because a lot of crystallographical sites and a lot of elements that are in this one. These are one of the last acquisition we have from one of the most well-known location. This location is called Bauer Powers Farm, And the tourmalin was collected there for more than 100 years, and still, look, there is still easy to collect. There are more trenches there, and now only they went also on the other side of the river following the trenches on other property, and they found very nice tourmalin too. Okay, see some of these, the same location, different forms. What is very important for this tourmaline? Everybody knows tourmaline as elongated minerals, yeah? See, these are not elongated. They are practically isometric, I can say, but they are not isometric because they are different properties. They are very nice, and we really like them. And because we talk about tourmalines, look at these ones. They are not so small. They are from pegmatite. It's called day pegmatite, and also in Saratoga County. Very nice. And you see, it's very clear. You have the striae along the C-axis, and you have this, you know, triangular shape with Z3 faces that goes to one point, which is characteristic for tourmaline. Very nice tourmaline. Same here, look, big ones from Overlook Quarry, day, the same day town. Some of them are smaller, some of them are well developed, well crystallized. And unfortunately, we don't have a gem tourmalines in New York, unfortunately. But we have very interesting tourmalines. Some of them are really nice. And going a little bit further, sorry, we'll go to another group of minerals, pyroxenes. The pyroxenes that, look at that one. I don't show all of them, but I'll show you only the one that present gem qualities. Also from San Lawrence County, Calvin Mitchell Farm. Beautiful stuff, and sometimes they are associated with tremolite, sometimes are replaced by tremolite, that amphiboles I talked a little bit about earlier. They are very nice, and not only they are very nice, but look at these ones here, yeah? This is a pyroxene. It's exactly the same as that one, green one, it's diopside. Only here it contains manganese and got this color. And the pink one is the amphibole that we call hexagonite on the other side when we talk about amphibole. The practically manganese here changed the color of them. They're very nice, and it was still there. A lot of this stuff is, the locality is called Arnold Pit, but because they have problems with locals, because of, they said, asbestos, you are not able to collect. I tried to go there. I talked with a lot of officials. Nobody let me go back in the pit. I went years ago before this issue appeared, but they didn't let me. Oh, this I'll show you later. This one from here. Now, somebody asked about diamond, yeah? Okay, let's go to see the diamond. Okie dokie.
We have a question if there was any green garnet in the collection.
We don't have. There were some, yes, it was from a quarry in northeastern Adirondacks, the Wollastonite quarry, and we had grossular green color from there, but was not good for museum. It's not a museum quality, then we kept him in a research collection. But if the person wants, can here and study it. Not a problem. Okay, sulfur diamond. Okay, diamond. See, this is the diamond. And this is the pyrope, the garnet that accompany diamond, and the rock is a lamproite. And it doesn't come from the United States. It comes from Russia, from a big pit that is called Mir, Peace Pit, which is very strange because it was ore for many, many years. It's very deep and very large, and it's a no-fly zone because the plane or the helicopter can be sucked up into the pit because of the air current. But they still mine, and the mineral is very nice. We still have also from South Africa some minerals. We have also some. See, this is the rock that contains diamond. We have some GE made industrial diamonds here for comparison. You can see the yellow, it is another mineral, it's the sulfur that is very close to the diamond. Diamond is a carbon that is practically carbon. You have graphite and you have diamond too. Graphite is for low temperature, low pressure, and diamond is deep in the earth form. And another thing I want to show you here, or also other minerals. Look, native copper. Native copper from Michigan, from Keweenaw Peninsula, very nice stuff. Still collecting some people, but not as before. And here, let's see what we have here. Okay, let me pull up a little bit. I think this is probably, no, here. Where did you go? See? Native gold in quartz. Again, nugget of gold from riverbeds. And this one, look at this one. That leaf. That is from a very well-known locality in Europe. It's from Romania, Transylvania. From that is Veres Patak, is from the old Hungarian, Austro-Hungarian Empire, for this in the Hungary name. And you have also, somebody said silver is a very nice mineral. Looks nice to you? The silver? It tarnish because silver doesn't like the light. In contact with light, it practically eliminate all the sulfur that has in composition, and sulfur is burned and gives this dark color. This seeds that are natural wires that are, or these ones are very interesting and can be still collecting. It is from a locality is called Cobalt, where silver is associated with bismuth, native bismuth, with uranium, with many nickel and other stuff. Very nice. Anyway, I like this. It was one of my first love, this kind of mineralizations. Didn't have time yet to go there to collect. Okay, let's go a little bit further. Oops. Okay. Yeah, we'll go here and then we'll come back here. We've seen that nice specimens of Amazonite from White Plains. Now I'll show you one more special from Colorado, from Pike Peaks, Colorado. That is important because it's one of the first specimens that were mined there. And not only, but it was described and photographed in many, many publications. Now we can go to the tourmaline. Again, it's not this, but this one, look at that ones. Different colors, manganese means the pink color, iron gives the little bit yellowish color. See, it was very nice, some of them. We had in the old times an exhibition of tourmalines down in, but there is no space at this moment for the tourmalines down there. We have some in the collection, and we have some also in there. And yeah, that is, I know everybody probably can compare and give a name to this. Watermelon. Looks like a watermelon slice. It's not ripe yet, but it's still okay. Very nice, showing the changing in composition in minor elements in the tourmaline. Okay, let's go a little bit further, and okay, let's go to not a very ugly minerals, but a very nice one, which is beryl, having from green color to colorless to bluish, aquamarine, everything you can find in this collection. It's not the only draw we have with this kind of minerals, but to save some time, we'll show only one draw, not more. Okay, if it is done, we can go further to show, probably people is interested in other specimens that can be cut and polished to make, which is the topaz. You can see here different colors for topaz, different locations we have the topaz from. Some crystals have the shape, some of them are with no crystalline shape. Depends how they are broken, because many collectors want to take it is a little bit, you know, practically hammer it to make more specimens to give to more person or to sell to more person. I really like this kind of minerals. I don't know why. Probably a lot of people like them. I know a lot of people like them because there are a lot of mineral clubs in New York State, and the oldest club, mineral club in the world in America was in New York City, and still active at this moment. And we have in the collection down there a lot of specimens from them exhibited in the display case Minerals of New York City. Okay, let's try to finish a little bit our journey. I forgot to show you guys the gems. I forgot the gems. See, we have also a big collection of gems, around 2,000 specimens. Of course, some of them are glass that shows, you know, the same type of polishing, the same type of color, the same type of faces of a natural one, but mostly are the corals. We have amber, we have pearls, we have all kind of stuff here. Look here, amber that is cut and polished, sometimes are rough specimens, some of other different resins that can be used as gems. They are not minerals, everybody knows, yeah? But they are still good for people. And down here, okay, we have the meteorites. The meteorites. Okay, not of them are. This is from Canyon Diablo, which is a very interesting mineral, from the, because it was used for sulfur isotopes at the beginning. Canyon Diablo. We have also some some meteorites that were found in New York. We can't say New York meteorites because they are not. They didn't grow up in New York. They came from outer space, but they landed in New York. One of them is this small piece here. We were able to acquire only this small piece. Is the Peekskill meteorite. For some people can probably recollect that years ago, it was a car that was hit by a meteorite. And this is part of this meteorite. And we have also some tektites here. We have some meteorites replica here, because the life-size Schenectady meteorite is in the Schenectady Museum. But we have a replica here that is still okay, comparing with the meteorites we have.
I have a question about where did the amber come from?
Baltica, from Scandinavia. Unfortunately, we don't have New York. Okay, let's do a little bit. Because being in different, I pull up some specimens. The minerals you can see here are the first time described in New York. That's for science. This is the oldest one described. It's an amphibole called Edenite. We don't know too much about it because there is not a precise locality, town at Edenville. Town is big, not a locality. Next one. It's Warwickite. I know where the precise location is, and the town is Warwick. The name is also that large, very nice crystal. This is also from that part down there in Amity is the Clintonite. It's a mica. And that is copper sulfide, the dark stuff. It's called gearite, and it was found somewhere in St. Lawrence County, but also without precise location. The collector, I think he passed away before they discovered the mineral and was not able to be questioned where the mineral was from. This is, especially look at the dark spot, is a pyroxene, orthorhombic pyroxene called dumpicorite, which seems to be the only location till this moment. Or could be another one, if we look in the mean depth for it. This one, it is a potassic fluorohastingsite, which is, see the arrow shows the mineral that was sampled. I don't know if all the minerals is exactly the same, but this one is the one that was analyzed and the crystal structure, chemical composition, and so on. That this is practically the type material and the type locality. And this is another one that was lost in the collection forever until I found it to be a fluoropargasite and describe it. It was in the collection. It is not, see, if you look at the specimen, doesn't say too much. Said Edenville, Orange County, New York, USA. No source, nothing. That is. But it is still from New York. Okay. And now let's look a little bit at what we call the Economic Geology Collection. And why do we call it Economic Geology? And we'll start with graphite. This is a graphite. This is the graphite ore from Ticonderoga. After this, it is, see, made smaller grains, smaller flakes, is concentrated. After this, it is make a powder of it, and then it is for pencils or a little bit crucible that is used for different purposes. Then this is why we call it this collection an economic geology collection, because we have the starting material that is the ore and then different phases until the end product. The same with garnet. See the garnets that are in the rock, they are crushed, they are made a little bit harder and lower size, and then they make the sandpaper. which is practically what we need for abrasives. Another resources of New York was talc. Everybody knows about talc. Look, that is the rock, the talc rock. These are the talc that is, see, used in grinding. There are pebbles that are used in grinding. And this is the powder that, but I have to tell you that the talc in New York is not for makeup. It's an industrial talc. It's not with such purity to be used for makeup. But it's still good. For magnetite, I don't think we have to talk too much because everybody knows the magnetite is the most important ingredient for steel. With chromium, with nickel, with other kind of elements they make it. What is important for New York is that at the beginning of 19th century, New York was the biggest iron supply of the United States. And it went into it and toward until the Mesabi Range came in activity and killed the mining in New York. There, because it's on the surface in open pit, here is underground. And there are a lot of other resources, iron resources and reserves that are down in the ground here in New York, but you can't use them. Important is another thing here, because some of these iron deposits in New York, especially in the eastern Adirondack, they are associated with apatite that contains rare earth elements, which are very important for high tech at this moment. Very interesting is in 1850 or 1860, they started to mine apatite, not magnetite, for fertilizer. But because the market didn't react very well to this, they moved toward, after this, in practically a new era for apatite came with the Manhattan Project, when the geologists started to look for radioactive minerals, and they found that apatite is radioactive, but not enough for their purpose. And after this, it was going and going and going until the rare elements came in fashion for everything, phones, color TV, windmills and weapons and everything. And now it is a Belgian company that has the mineral rights on this apatite there. And probably they will stay there forever, being in the state park. Nobody will make any processing plant there or something like that. But important is we have them. Now, as a bonus for ending our journey, I'll show you some interesting rocks. First, look at this one, which is a folded rock, a metamorphic rock that was folded due to pressure and temperature during the granulate phases in the Adirondacks. It was collected in 1940, and you can see here, it was by Hartnagel. I think Hartnagel was the state geologist at that moment. Another interesting stuff is this one, which is a very nice gypsum that is very small, folded into the layers. Probably it was initially an anhydrite, and after this, due to the water, it became gypsum. Gypsum has a bigger volume, didn't have room enough, and started to fold around this one. After this, I'll show you this. It's a very nice piece of pegmatite showing the crystallization of quartz and feldspath at one temperature point, which is very interesting. I don't want to get into the details because will be too technical. I don't know that people would like to know too much about this. I'll leave it alone a little bit later. See, it's ugly, for this we leave alone. But this is what we call kimberlite. You know, kimberlite is a rock that in other parts of the world contains diamonds. Somebody asked about this, I think, earlier. And in 1837, Venaxen, that was the geologist hired by Governor Marcy for the western central part of New York, found dikes of these rocks Nobody knew at that moment what a kimberlite is. And looking at the composition, they said it's a mica peridotite. Okay, that is recorded in his report, and that's it. In 30 years later, they found these rocks at Kimberley, South Africa, with diamond. And they said, oh, there are some in New York. Let's go there to look for. They started to look, and to look, they found more than 80 dikes of these rocks, and also a small diatreme, but unfortunately, why? Because they are too shallow. And this one is the same, it's a kimberlite that Cayuga Salt Company cut the salt, a kimberlite dike that cut the salt there. In Pennsylvania, another dike of this set of kimberlites cut the coal seam there. Now, okay, see this rock? It's a sandstone, yeah? But look at it. It moves. You can be, you know, look at it, you can fold it, not too much because you'll break it, but show me another rock that can do this. This is the only rock. The popular name is Ita columbite. And this is from North Carolina, this one. We have here, we have two pieces in the collection from these rocks. And I think I, you know, I was enough boring for you guys to tell these kind of stories. And if you want something, you can email me and let me know what you are interested in, and I can answer to you. Thank you for listening.